Well, amen. If you ain't awake, you awake now. Amen. Amen. Shout that from the rooftops. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Amen. Amen. It's great to see you this morning here in the house of worship. Before we get started, I just want to, the Samuel family wanted me to thank Believers Fellowship for everything that you did. We had Mr. Sam's funeral yesterday, and it was just a great time of fellowship. It just really honored. It really honored the Lord, and so the family wanted me to just send their thank you and their love. They felt it as they came in, and the fellowship. So thank you for all that prepared a meal, and Stephanie, thank you, you and your team for putting that together. So thank y'all. And amen. That's what we're called to be, the hands and feet. Amen. And amen. So thank you. That just, again, they couldn't stop saying how much they felt the love of the Lord as they stepped into our church. So thank you for just being there for them. It's great to see everybody here, especially our first time visitors. When you came in, and sat down, there's a welcome card and a seat back in front of you. We'd ask that you fill that out at the end of the service. We'd love the opportunity to meet you, greet you, put a free gift in your hand. But instead of me standing from up here, members, regular attenders, get from where you are and greet somebody this new. Please return to your seats and remain standing. I know we love the fellowship because we're Believers Fellowship, but if you could please stand, and we're going to honor the Lord with the reading of his word. I'm going to ask Ms. Laurel to come up, and we're going to be in Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 38. Is this working?
Morning. So we're in Mark 8, 34 through 38. And he summoned the crowd together with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the Gospels will save it. For what does it profit a person to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? And what would a person give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." Let's pray. Father God, we just love you so much. We thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for the freedom to be able to come and worship you in a house that's warm, in a house that's honored and dedicated to you, Father. And Lord, I just ask that you would teach us the words that I've read this morning, that we would come, after we would choose to come after you, and that we would deny ourselves and we would take up our cross and follow you, Father. Those are such important words to us. And Father, I ask that you would teach us these things one step at a time. It may seem elementary, but it's not. It's not at all. And Father, we just thank you for that opportunity. I thank you that we serve a church that loves you and that pushes us beyond our limits and gets us out of our comfort zone. That's what we need, Father. So, Lord, I ask for words to hear and ears to hear, and our hearts would be open this morning as we hear your word from Brother Joe, spoken through him. Now, Father, we would receive it and move in whatever way we need to. Father, we just thank you. Thank you for this opportunity and time. We love you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please remain standing.
Offering for our sin and presented himself as a sacrifice so that we do not have to experience this judgment that is before us. I mean, just let you think, man, what a loving God. But if there is no hell, and the Bible says all these things about hell, and there is no hell, then it's just a book of fables. It's just as good as Aesop's fables and fairy tales and should just be thrown away. But however, The Bible is true, and God does speak about these things. Holy men of God were moved by the Holy Spirit and wrote these things to us. All scripture, the Bible says, is given by inspiration of God, and the word of God is alive. It's quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It is God's word to us, and it is true. So let me just contend, because very clearly based upon this, there is a hell. And if there is a hell, then it is certainly a place that we would want to avoid. Yes, there are intellectuals who will scoff at the idea, laugh at the idea. You can find them all over the internet if you so desire to search. They're all there. I've had preachers even tell me, you really shouldn't preach these messages about hell. It just has a tendency to scare people. Well, it's a good reason to be scared. As I said, I try not to preach it too much from an emotional basis, but a very pure logical basis. One here is what the Bible teaches. You know, I want to be under a preacher and a teacher that believes the Bible and will teach the whole counsel of the Word of God. And is not afraid to just to share the truth as it is written in the Word of God and to say what God says about it. And even, you know, if I think that there's a cancer in my body, and I start looking for a doctor, and they start to give me their little bios. If y'all have done some of the doctor searches before, and you can go to the internet and get their stuff. And I read about a doctor says, oh, my name is Dr. So-and-so. Here's my degrees. Here's my education. You know, here's my skill set. I've been in practice so many years. But, hey, I'm not one of those doctors who believes in the myth of cancer. I don't think I'm going to go to him. Because cancer can be a reality. And I want to go to a guy who knows how to deal with that. Amen. It's the same thing with spiritual truth and spiritual life. I need the right word. I need the word of God. So you say, well, why do you believe in hell? Well, that's a pretty good question. Let me give you a few reasons, and I'll tell you the most important reason. One, I was taught as a child about heaven and hell. I had a godly mother who believed the word of God, who was not hesitant to teach me the truth about these things and to let me know very early on in my life, this is not a place you want to go spend eternity. I grew up in a church that taught, you know, about hell. I was in a denomination that preached about hell. As I got older and began to read the history of some of the great men of God and the great preachers of God and what they believed and how God used and influenced them, they all believed in hell. You know, I mean, think about it. Even culturally, don't we separate, or we used to at least separate those people who did wrong, were evildoers and wicked people. They do crimes against society and, you know, we put them in jail, all right? So culturally, there's that mindset. But most of all, I believe in hell for one reason. I believe in hell because the Word of God teaches it. This is what the Bible says, and this is what we're to believe. And it doesn't matter that many people around you will say, well, there really is no hell. And the more you try to necessarily debate, it turns into an argument a lot of time. It's really just based upon, when you talk to them, emotionalism. You know, it just gets down to this emotional, like, well, I just can't believe that, or I just can't believe that God would do that. And they just get into this thing, you know, they don't want to talk about it. It's almost this hostility and even an unwillingness to consider rationally about the reality of eternity and heaven and hell. But it is a matter of importance, and it is a matter of utmost importance that every child of God needs to understand. In fact, every person who's not a child, they should hear a message, they should hear the truth about what is coming down the pike when we talk about end times and we talk about prophecy, that all this thing's going to end up in one of two places. It's going to be heaven or it's going to be hell. Now, the second biggest reason that people reject this truth, most of the time you get into an argument, Pastor, God's a loving God, and God just loves everybody, you know. It's kind of like these universal preachers, universalism. Let me give you the Joe Arms definition of universalism. It goes like this. It's a belief that God really didn't mean what he said in the Bible, and at the end of time, God's just going to bring everybody before him and say, I was just kidding. You know, everybody can come in. It's cool. It's okay. That's not going to happen like that. The truth of the matter is that the Word of God is very clear about what it says about hell and the truth, and it doesn't matter what our emotional arguments might be, or we can contend that God is love. Well, let me say, God is love, and because of the reality of hell, in his love, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish in eternity. In hell is what he's talking about. Later on in John, that same chapter, he's talking about, we're already condemned because we don't believe. We've rejected God. Every man's turned to his own ways. So as we talk about the love of God, long before scriptures begin to teach us about the love of God, even though we can see it manifest in so many places, it talks about the holiness of God. That God is God. There's nobody like God. We've used the term before, that theological term for that means unchanging, that he is an immutable God. That he was the same yesterday, he is the same today, he will be the same forever, the scripture teaches. God doesn't change. Yes, culture changes, people change, men change, women change. Hey, but God doesn't change. What God has been for, he has always been for. If God says, thou shalt not kill, you know what that means? When he wrote it, you don't kill. You know what it meant yesterday? Don't kill. And the word literally, don't do murder. What's it mean today? Oh, you know, it's changed. No, it still means the same. God talks about, you know, in revealing his holiness, he says, basically saying, I'm not a murderer. All right? When God says, you know, you don't steal, God's saying, I'm not a thief. All right, so what did that mean then? It means he wasn't a thief. What's it mean today? He's not a thief. What's it mean tomorrow? He's not a thief. He does identify the thief. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But God is first and foremost a holy God. It means literally there's no one like God. He is distinct and unique, never has been one like him, never again will there be one like him. He is God, 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 and I'm not, and neither are you. He's God, there's no one like him. His word is eternal. His ways are past finding out. He is not like us. We are completely different from God. We are made, although in God's image, but we will never even be anything towards being like God until we know Christ, who begins this work of transformation and sanctification in our life and makes us holy. But you remember what Isaiah the prophet talked about, how that God is holy, and he has this revelation of God and his holiness, and his train fills the temple, and his glory fills the temple. And remember, there's the cherubim. They're flying around the throne of God with their wings, and they're declaring, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. And it's just this declaration. They're not singing, God is love. I'm not singing, God is peace. God is peace. They're not singing, God is joy. God is joy. Singing, God is holy, which basically means that we should recognize that and honor him for exactly who he is. He's God. And because we do not glorify God as God, it has separated us from God. We are by nature sinners, and it's our natural thing to kind of put ourselves in that position and do what we want, what we desire in our own will and way. But when we begin to recognize that we're separated from God, we realize the grace of God in loving us and the love of God through Jesus Christ, then we can be made right with God. But we need to understand that God being holy is opposed to sin. The scriptures even tell us, as much as God loves us, as long as we're in our sin, we are enemies of God. This, our attitude is hostile towards God. Our way of living is hostile toward God. But God in his mercy, yes, and in his love, he does send Jesus, but it does not detract nor take from his holiness. I mean, God is not some blustering fool up there who doesn't know what he means when he says what he says. He knows exactly what he means. He declares in scripture, makes it clear that his sin is unacceptable in his sight, and that it is because of sin, the wages of it is death. Appreciate what Isaiah the prophet, when he made a statement, he said, you know, his ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. They're past founding out. And I think so many times we want to take God, and we talk about things like hell especially, and put him in our little box of thinking and try to bring him down to human form and say, well, that's not what that really means. When you begin to approach the Word of God with that mindset, you're completely way off base. You take the Word of God and you read it for what it says. In fact, the Scripture says of itself, it's not from my private or my personal interpretation. Now, that's the popular way of approaching the Bible these days. A lot of people, they begin when they start having a theological discussion, will say something like this. Well, I see it this way. Well, that's fine if you see it the way it says. But if you see it the other way than what it says, you see it wrong. And the problem is we see a lot of things wrong because sin has also led to our personal deception and our personal blindness, and we've completely missed God. Think about the Lord Jesus Christ. Here he comes as the Lamb, the offering for our sin upon the cross, to give himself for our sin. And he makes no bones whatsoever about teaching the reality of sin. I mean, here comes Jesus, the very personification of love. But he talked more about this subject than all the other prophets or preachers before him. And he comes to tell people that hell is very real. I mean, think meek and mild Jesus Christ He comes to tell us the reality about hell so that we might be saved from that eternal pain and that eternal suffering that comes along with it. Now, if it's not real, then that means that he simply came to tell us a fairy tale, as I said earlier, to plant some fear in our minds that really doesn't exist. Why would he do that? He didn't do that, is the answer. He came and declared truth to us. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. His message is clear, his words are true, and he speaks a great deal. The prophets also speak, but there's other passages all through Scripture. We can make a long list today, and I'll give you some passages. But, you know, the Scripture is just full of reality about the existence of hell. Isaiah 33 says that sinners dwell in everlasting burning. Psalms 42:19, they shall never see the light, they shall utterly be consumed. That's devastating. Isaiah 26 talks about a fire that's not quenched, an everlasting dead. Mark 9:44 says, where the worm dieth not. Psalm 7:2, where there is none to deliver. So if the word is so clear on this issue, it should give us some kind of pause to say, hey, okay, I need to consider this. And I need to see the reality of this. And I need to understand that the only escape from this is through the precious offering that Jesus made of himself for my sin, to take my place as King James Version, my propitiation, my stand-in. If you want to go through just a brief, I think, summation of what hell is like, there's lots of scriptures. I'll just give you 5 or 6, maybe 7 that talk about what hell is really like. The Bible says it is a place of real fire that will not be it's a fire that's real, and it will not consume, though. It's a fire that tortures, it's a fire that punishes, it's a fire that judges, but it doesn't consume you. Well, how do you get that? You know, I have to be honest every once in a while. I don't know. I try to be honest all the time, by the way, all right? But I don't understand how Moses stood before a burning bush that wasn't consumed either. And it was on fire, yet the bush didn't get consumed. So it's not something that we just see that's out of the ordinary. It's something that's out of the context of what the Lord is like. And I know some people say, well, and have told me, well, Pastor, you know, that's really just a simile. Okay, let's go with that. If that fire is a simile, how much worse could it be? It has to be more devastating than even that. But look at in Luke, where Jesus says, it talks about them being tormented in flames. In Mark, where it says the fire is not quenched. In the book of Revelation, as John is getting this word in heaven, it's about a lake that burns with fire. In 19 and 20 says they're cast alive into the fire. Matthew 25, Jesus is speaking about people who profess to know him but really didn't know him, and they were what we call apostates. They were pretend believers. Says they'll depart into everlasting fire. Those are some serious phrases and verses in Scripture that we should certainly pay attention to that talk about fire. But it's also a place of separation. You may remember the story of the rich man and Lazarus, how that he was separated from Lazarus, and he's in hell, and, you know, he's begging just for a drop of water to be placed on his lips because he's separated. I would contend that what makes hell more hell than anything else in hell is the fact, if it is like the rich man in that story — Jesus didn't say it was a parable, by the way, our story, so it had to be an incident, all right — that rich man can see beyond where he's at, and the idea or the knowledge, just the knowing that I can't be where everything is right and everything is good and where God is, that must be what makes hell more hell than anything else. Separated for all of eternity from that. The Scriptures teach it as a place of no satisfaction. In other words, you're just being consumed by desire, but none of those desires can be met. That whether it's thirst, like the rich man, just a drop of water for all of eternity, like that, to be experiencing something like that. I believe that the drug addict will still crave his drugs. The alcoholic will still crave his alcohol. The person who's been bound by these things for these abnormal or these ungodly or these unholy drives and impulses will still be experiencing those impulses, but with no way to satisfy any of those things. The homosexual will still crave his perversion. The adulterer and the fornicator will still be consumed with his own lust, but no expression of any satisfaction whatsoever. Revelation 22, 11 puts it this way. He that is unjust and filthy is unjust still. The fourth thing about the hell, it's a place of no escape. There's no place to hide. There's no door you can break down. There's no chains you can rattle out of and escape from. The Catholics, by the way, on this particular thing are completely wrong. There is no place where you're going to go like purgatory, and if people pay enough or pray enough, can get you out of that place. The Bible says nobody in heaven will be there because of somebody's works. Not anybody's. The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. So you make your decisions in this life. Or you accept Christ or you reject Christ while God has given you this opportunity. It's a place of no escape. Fifth, it's a place of isolation, enveloped in darkness. I remember right after I gave my life to the Lord, I started quickly looking up my friends and my party mates, you know, the people I would party with, and I partied hardy, all right? I've said before, I thought I was the Ayatollah Partyola. So I began to look these guys up, tell them I'd give my life to Jesus. And I knew where they'd be because they all gathered at certain places at certain times, especially on the weekends after a long week of partying hardy. Kind of Sunday was come down day. And I'd be passing out Valium and stuff like that, you know, just to get over the headaches and the miseries of the hangovers. So I would go over there and I began to tell them about Jesus. I remember one guy just, oh, yeah, arms, man, you know, you're just weak, man. You're just lame. You know, you need a crutch. That Christianity stuff's a crutch. I simply said, I wasn't lame, buddy. I was dead. There was no life. Christ brought life to me. But another line was given to me by my friends at that point in time was, you know, I don't care about hell. I'm just going to go to hell and party with my friends. That's not the way it's going to be. The Bible says that hell is this place of incredible isolation. There's no partying that's going on. And although the devil might try to sell you that bill of goods, he's not going to be partying when he's in there. All right? It's a place of isolation. And sixth thing, it's a place of constant dying. Revelation 20:14, everlasting torment, everlasting fire. The smoke of the torment lasts forever. There's many people that I've over the years and 50 years of ministry and 35 years of pastoring, I have been by the side of the bed of a lot of people that are in their last moments dying. Some that were conscious. And it's extremely, incredibly difficult to know that person that doesn't know Jesus and to watch them die in such anguish and such fear. It's heartbreaking. On the other hand, to watch those who are passing into eternity, who are smiling, who are reaching up, who are singing. I remember we had this friend, we back when I was an evangelist, we used to go to Spring Baptist. We had a friend by the name of the Robinson. Some of you might remember Jackie Robinson. What was her name? Jackie. Her husband told me on her last day of life, he left the room for a little bit, and she was just, you know, she knew she was passing. She loved Jesus about more than anybody I know. He said, when I came back into the room, she had passed away. He said, but she had gotten out of bed and gotten on her knees and had her hands folded in front of her, just recognizing, I believe, the glory and the majesty that she's going to. Christy, my sister's here on the front row, sitting by Kathy. She was there when my grandfather was passing away, and I'll probably get this story wrong, but the essence of it is correct, is that I think we were somewhere across the country in a revival, Kathy and I were, and Charity and Christy had gone to my grandfather's side. We called him Pappy. Pappy was just a dear man. He was a great man. You know, he was one of these guys who literally, you know, you heard this before, give the shirt off back. He would literally do that. He was one of those kind of men. Just a great, great guy. He loved people. He loved helping people and being there for people. Quiet kind of guy, unassuming, didn't want any attention about it all. But Pappy had been a good guy, but he just had never given his life to Jesus. He knew about the Lord. He grew up in a Presbyterian church. But as he's on his deathbed, he begins to wail and to scream. Put it out. Somebody put these flames out. Put it out. Christy and Charity there go to his side, begin to pray, begin interceding, because we've been praying for Pappy for years to come to know the Lord. And yes, I do believe people can get saved on their deathbed, because nothing merits us for heaven but Jesus. And he's crying, wailing, and they begin to pray and intercede over him and lay hands on him, just pray for him. God just opens his heart and mind. And he's cognizant. And he said, Pappy, you just need to give your heart to Christ. You don't need to wait another day. And eventually he comes to this place and he's praying, and Lord, I'm a sinner, please forgive me, come to my heart, give me a new life, deliver me from this hell. And then the whole atmosphere changes. This presence of God is just being manifested instead of the heaviness of that moment. And Christy Charity, I know what you said, well, let's sing something. And Christy said, let's sing when we all get to heaven. Charity said, well, maybe not that. So they start singing, and he's singing along with them. And there's just this glorious joy, and as time goes by, he's going to sleep, and they leave the room for a while, and then he calls them back in there, and he says, can y'all hear that? You can't hear that? You don't hear that singing? And he passed into eternity. The death of the believer is so much better than the death of the unbeliever, because we have a hope that's real and it's genuine. And we move into everlasting life, not everlasting death, but hell, it's an everlasting death. Someone said, how long is eternity? It might have been Billy Graham who made the statement, if you took a sparrow and he were to fly to the Atlantic and put one drop of water in his mouth and fly across the continent and put that drop in the Pacific, by the time he empties the Atlantic and takes every drop to the Pacific, eternity's only just begun. It's a long time. And if we want to have it the way that God intended for it to have it, we need to surrender our hearts and our life to Jesus, because we are all deserving of hell. We have all resisted God. We have all gone our own way. We've all gone astray. That makes it very clear in the Word of God. There's no doubt that no matter how even decent, moral, upright we may well be in our own thinking, we're still separated from God by our sin. Scripture says it is a place of weeping. Why weep? I mean, the torment, no satisfaction. The opportunities, I think, are heard again and again. The opportunities, the church services we sit on, or the Christians we turn down, or the preacher we saw on the TV, or the radio message, or the bulletin board. I believe that part of hell will be everything will remind us of every opportunity that we ignored we'll see again. That will make hell hell. That will make the horrors of hell even more incredible. Opportunities lost. I think also the separation, as I said a while ago, from God and everything that's holy. Also add to that, remember the rich man? Please, somebody, go tell my relatives not to come to this horrible place. Send somebody to tell them not to come to this horrible place. Why do people go to hell? We're already bound there. The Bible says we're condemned already. But this is an interesting passage in Revelation. To the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the immoral persons, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars will have their part in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That is an interesting list. The cowardly, the unbelieving. Now, we want to take those two and kind of separate it from the rest, because the other's bad. I mean, the wicked, the sorcerer, the idolater, you know, the immoral person. You know, I'm not all that bad. Don't put me on that list. But it even says unbelievers. It was Jesus who made that statement. It's we're condemned already, you know, that we need to come to Christ. But who's going to be in this crowd? Maybe it's the cowardly. They wouldn't come to grips with themselves. They didn't want to face the fact that they needed God. They thought they were sufficient in themselves. They thought that money was the answer, or that people were the answer, or they could resolve, I don't need anybody else. I pull myself up by my own bootstraps. I'm a man's man. If you're not a man that belongs to God, you're not a man yet. You're not a man yet. You're not a woman yet until you're God's man or you're God's woman. Jesus made it clear about this issue repeatedly in his ministry. He believes in him, talking of himself in Jesus, is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already, because he's not believed in the name of the only one begotten Son of God. When we need to understand that there's been no place since the day I drew my first breath that I was good enough for heaven. I was born in sin. My first breath I drew in this world was as a little baby sinner. That the first words out of my mouth were selfishness and self-centered. Mommy, my toy, my this, my that. Give me this. It's just our nature. We can try to tame it. We can try to civilize it. But all in all, we are a pagan without God and lost without God and have no hope. And our opportunity to know Christ is in that moment that the Holy Spirit convicts us and begins to draw us to himself. That's what we need to pay attention to. That's what we need to hear. Jesus paid the price. That cauldron of hell, of sin and death, was literally poured out on him. My God, why have you forsaken me? As he who knew no sin became my sin and your sin on the cross. It was John Hanna who wrote this statement. He said, you know, no one who is ever in hell will be able to say to God, you put me here. And no one who's in heaven will be able to say, I put myself here. You can put yourself in hell, but you can't put yourself in heaven. Only Jesus can put you there. So you have to surrender and avail yourself to his mercy and to his grace and his love. Hell is the judgment of God that a person will be eternally banished from his presence. It's not that God is torturing people in hell. Hell is torment. The torture is understanding and knowing we didn't do what we should have done when we had the opportunity. Augustine said this, our hearts are restless, O Lord, until they rest in thee. You know, imagine the hopeless despair of an eternal existence in which no one can never be what they were created to be. You were created in the image of God, made to know God, and made to walk with God. But we are so selfish in ourselves, we fight that with almost every fiber of our being, determined to do what we want and live how we want. Imagine the sorrow of that, the heartbreak of that, and the pain of that, and the frustration of that. You can't even begin to hardly really imagine it. What should that cause us to do? I think it should cause us, first of all, to be saved. We need to come to a knowledge of the Savior. Now, I'm probably not talking to people who are just now hearing this for the first time in their life, right? But I would not doubt that there may be some like myself who sat in the crowd and heard this message, who'd heard it most of their life and were still rejecting it, still wrestling with it. In church, wrestling with it. Leaving church, wrestling with it. Running from conviction, still wrestling with it. It's the Holy Spirit of God just kept dealing with me. And there comes a point in time that you need to surrender to the voice of conviction and be this believer, all right? We should be saved. Now, I'm not going to get into the arguments of sovereignty and Calvinism and all that. I just want you to know the Bible is very clear that when you hear his voice, you should respond to it. You should say yes to the Lord Jesus and give your heart and your life to him. Make the choice for Christ against yourself, against your sin, against your will, against your way, because your ways are the ways of death. Then we should be warning the lost. We should do exactly what Jesus told us to do. Go to the nations. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out season. If you ever read that in the Amplified Bible, it might shake you. It says, preach the word. It's talking to all Christians. Tell the truth, whether it's convenient, whether it's inconvenient. Whether people are accepting it or not accepting it. Just speak the word of God. If we believe this, we should preach this, shouldn't we? We should stay surrendered, I believe, because that's even when our witness becomes even more effective. Now, I believe that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, the Jew first, the Greek also, but also know that there's certain power and more great and greater grace that's in a situation in our witness when we're living for Christ with a really committed heart to Jesus Christ, that the effects of that are even more impactful in people's lives. They see the testimony, they hear the word, and then they see it carried out in our actions and in our life. We don't just adjust like some kind of thermostat changing temperatures, you know, like a thermometer to whatever that's going on around us. We set the temperature. We walk in and we are light and we are salt and we just choose to be what God called us to be. Jesus said, ye shall be my witnesses. He just said that's what we are. All right, you're a witness, whether you're saying it or not. You're a witness, whether you're in public or not. You're a witness. You're always a witness no matter where you are. You're a witness. And so your words should line up with your life, that the testimony it's giving, that your mouth and your words align with the word of God and with the things of God so that people see the reality of Jesus Christ in you. Listen, God is moving across this planet right now in incredible ways, and most of us in America have no idea what the Lord's really doing. There are things that God is doing in third world countries and communist countries, in Iran and Iraq and places like China and Cuba, you know, that we just have no idea what's going on. But thousands of people are coming to Christ in this day and age. And those people are standing true no matter what the cost is, and it's costing many of their lives. In places like Nigeria, where they're being taken out and slaughtered because of their faith in Jesus Christ. Today that'll happen. You should. Every once in a while, Siri wants to get saved, but I haven't been able to work it out yet. I think there's a greater evil involved there. But we should be living for Jesus Christ completely and wholeheartedly. I was looking, and I shared these words in a funeral. My services and Gary's and Tim, Brother Tim's, they're not like normal funeral services. We take these opportunities to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. But I shared the last words of famous atheist Thomas Hobbes, a political philosopher, on his dying bed. I say again, if I had the whole world at my disposal, I would give it all to live one more day. I'm about to take a leap into the dark. No hope there. Thomas Paine, you should be familiar with him if you studied history. He was a leading atheistic writer in the colonies. He wrote the book of The Age of Reason. On his deathbed, these words are recorded. He says, stay with me for God's sake. I cannot bear it alone. I can't bear to be left alone. Oh, Lord, help me. Oh, God, what have I done to suffer so much? What will become of me hereafter? I would give the worlds if I had them, that The Age of Reason had never been published. Oh, Lord, help me. Christ, help me. Do not leave me. Stay with me. Send even a child to stay with me, for I am on the edge of hell here alone. And if ever the devil had an agent, I have been that one. Y'all are probably familiar with the name of Anton LaVey, wrote the Book of Satan, a priest in Church of Satan, author of the Satanic Bible. His last words, well, one of his famous quotes while he was living was something like, well, there's a beast in man that needs to be exercised, not exorcised. In other words, we should live to our fullest potential of evil. His dying words were much different. Oh my, what have I done? There's something very wrong. There's something very, very wrong. As he stands on the precipice of hell. Then you see others, the Apostle Paul. I mentioned him yesterday in a funeral we had, where he's standing. He says, the time of my departure is now come. He said, I'm getting ready to die. This is it. And they're going to carry him out in just a few days and behead him, all right? He knows the end is near. The time of my departure is near. But he continued to preach the message, oh, death, where's thy sting? Oh, grave, where's your victory? Sting and victory of death is gone, swallowed up in the grace of God and the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Apostle Paul wrote these words, for me to live, is Christ. But to die, that's a gain. King David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because of the presence of God. In those moments, Jesus Christ, I am the resurrection and I am the life, and he that believes on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Now, I was doing my usual peruse through Facebook this week, and I came across a post that a preacher friend that I knew had posted, and I thought, I think share that, and I kind of argued with myself. I know I shouldn't show that because it's an atheist, and maybe you saw this post. That's posting this, and he's railing against Christians in this atheist, you know, and how hypocritical Christians are, and I can agree with him in this post. But it was, you know, the magicians, Jack Penn and Teller. Now, if you've ever followed these guys off screen or anything, they're pretty wicked guys as far as the Bible's concerned. They have no belief in God whatsoever. Penn is a avowed atheist, you know, mocks God, Christianity, Jesus Christ, all that. But somebody posted this little quote that he had, and Karen, if you've got that, why don't you just pull that up right quick, and it's about a minute long. Let me just play this for you from a perception of an atheist.
I don't respect people who don't proselytize. I don't respect that at all. If you believe that there's a heaven and hell, and people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think that, well, it's not really worth telling them this because it would make it socially awkward. And atheists who think that people shouldn't proselytize, just leave me alone, keep your religion to yourself. How much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate somebody to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? I mean, if I believed beyond a shadow of a doubt that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe it, that truck was bearing down on you, there's a certain point where I tackle you. And this is more important than that.
It is more important than that. It is more important than that. And unfortunately, unless he comes to Christ, he's going to discover just how much bigger than a truck it would be coming down the road to hit you. But that is a powerful statement, you know, from a perspective of somebody who's a complete non-believer to say, if you really believe the truth about heaven and hell, why aren't you telling people that? No, he's going to explode as much as he can with a judgmental attitude, and the devil uses that same technique all the time to keep you. So load you down with condemnation. You know, I just can't be, I'm not going to. Hey, but listen, God has called us to be the messengers for the kingdom. He's equipped us. He's given us his Holy Spirit. He lives in us. Praise God, he's given us his word. He's given us each other as a church body to keep and encourage and to lift each other up. He's given us avenues and share the gospel. We should be doing what God's called us to do. We are so preoccupied with this world around us, we've completely missed the mark. And I have shared with you that, but I think it's relevant to me to saying this again. When I first started working behind communist countries many years ago, to hear preachers that would say to me, and I'd go to them, and I always feel so humbled when I would stand before these groups of hundreds of preachers and to share truth and to Bible teaching, just sharing and ministering with them, and just saying, you know what, how humbling it was to know what they had suffered for and how many of them had lost family and loved ones. And many of the men I would preach in those early conferences to had been in jail multiple times and beaten multiple times by USSR, you know, KGB guys. Hauled off to jail multiple occasions, sent to Siberia and work in freezing cold conditions for a year, two, 3 years at a time. And I remember going to dinner with one of them in their home one time, and I was just telling me, you know, I would hope my faith is that strong. And he says, you know, he said, I think it's easier for me than for you. So what do you mean? He says, you live in a land where everything is so accessible. Every wickedness, every evil imaginable, it's right before you. All the time, surrounded by it. The lust of the ages, I mean, the love for money, the thing, the wonder of all the world has to offer, the world in its worst sense. He said, and to stay strong in that environment and to stay righteous in that environment and keep plugging for Jesus in that environment and not give way to the subtlety of all that temptation. He says, I admire you for that. I guess perspective's a big deal, isn't it? But maybe we need to get our perspective right. How many of us are letting those things pull us aside and keep us? The worries of this world, the cares of riches, Jesus said, would choke the seed of the word of God in us. Do we believe the Bible? Our job as pastors of Believers Fellowship and every leader in the church is to equip each other for the work of the ministry, especially the pastoral role of a shepherd, is equipping the saints for the work of the ministry. We're doing the work of the ministry, but we're also equipping you to do the work of the ministry. And to equip you means to train you, teach you, and give you tools, but also opportunities. When I was preparing my messages, this series of messages I prepared long before we started working a year ago in our staff retreat when we start planning out events for the year. And we'd started this event back when, right before COVID hit, we wanted to do this Invite Your One event. And it's more than, and we've had lots of evangelistic days and evangelistic events. Those days you know, hey, I can bring this person. I know the gospel's going to be preached on that day. We're going to preach the gospel every Sunday, by the way. It might not be the part you're wanting to for just for that lost person to hear the specific word. But we have these events, and we've done everything you can imagine just to start praying and putting prayer in place and start inviting people and encouraging people. We have this event that comes up just a few weeks from now, March 5th, called Invite Your One. Some of you have been aware, and some of you have started praying about who your one is. You've started inviting your one. We put some cards on the seats when you sit down today to remind you. This common invite cards we use all the time. It's got a little line on there that kind of looks like a blank line on there. That's where you put your phone number when you give it to somebody. Or your email letter to say, get in touch with me. Or you say, hey, if you got something, call me. Those invite cards are always scattered around the lobby somewhere on our table back here. You can always pick up a handful at a time or several a week each week you want to go out and just to use to invite people to church. We want to always be inviting people to Christ, but I think one of the great opportunities that we have in our nation that a lot of nations don't have is this opportunity to have a church that's filled with people who love Jesus and want to share truth and the gospel with people. So we're having this event, this Invite Your One. I'm stuttering myself. You know, you can invite more than one, by the way, okay? The context here, what we've been trying to aim for is that there probably is somebody that even while I was preaching this sermon that came to your mind, maybe somebody that's in your family, somebody you love, maybe somebody you work with, but would you participate in this opportunity? The focus of that Sunday is just, the message of the Sunday is just the gospel message, you know? Jesus came, he died and revived, and the purpose behind it all, and he's coming again. And we need to be ready. So we're going to be sharing March 5th very clear, simple message with a call to open your heart, receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. We're not going to be offering prizes to people to get saved or anything else. Just give people an opportunity to open their heart to Christ. I've had people who've, let me just say through it, you have somebody on your heart and mind, this is your opportunity. Now, I would encourage you to do this because we also have people praying over this event. And then Wednesday, this Wednesday or next week, we're having next Wednesday, right before that Sunday, we're having just a prayer meeting. I want you to come, and we'll be bringing those names to the altar and praying for them, and just like that, we'll be praying for all the names that are put on the banner. It's out there as you go on the right. You know, there's some post-its you can take. You don't have to write a whole name, right? Just say, I'm praying for Sue, and put it up on the wall, or I'm praying for Joe or Tim or whoever it might be. I'm just praying for this person that I'm believing to come. You want to put two or three up there, put them up, because we're going to be lifting those up to the Lord as well and lifting you up to the Lord as well. Now, I shared with you a few weeks ago that when I started praying over this and we're putting these things together, and I shared with the staff, said, my circle of influence as far as sinners is not near what it used to be. I used to be, in my life, that's all I knew was sinners. I'm talking about people who don't know Jesus because we're all sinners, right? But I work at a church, by the way, guys, all right? I'm surrounded by Christians. Most of my interactions, even when I'm not at the church, are with believers. Most of my contacts and my phone calls and all that, it's mostly with believers. My relationships, I'm going to go out to dinner, it's usually believers, all right? And I thought, the Lord just really convicted me. You need to make some changes there. Jesus came to seek and save sinners. You've got arms, you've got plenty of opportunity with the believers. You may make more opportunities for the lost. And then God just began to say, You're in contact with folks every day. You slow down. Just slow down. They're there. Ministry's right in front of you all the time. Take a breath. Look around the room. You don't have to get to that next spot exactly on the minute. We just rush, hurry. Got our list for the day. We just zoom through, getting our stuff done. And just miss completely all those ministry opportunities. If hell is real, and I believe it is, heaven is real. We should be doing what we can do to make a difference in the world around us. And I said, I didn't want to preach this with a lot of emotion because what happens, you know, we get all stirred up, but we don't get changed. All right? We need to be changed, not stirred. You know, we need to listen to that conviction. We don't need to say, well, Brother Joe stepped on my toes. I am not aiming for your feet. I'm preaching to your heart. So if I need to pull my sights, I'm not trying to step on your toes. I'm not trying to make you feel bad. You know, that's not okay. I just want us to be what God's called us to be. Because there is a move of God that's happening in the world today. And my heart's desire before I draw my last breath on this side of eternity is to see one more great move of God in the country, across the globe. It's stirring. There's little pockets right now in America where it's stirring. Places where people just meet with God. God's moving in these prayer circles. And people are starting to just sense the presence of God in very unique, special ways. I'm not talking about spotlights and concerts and all that. No, just the precious voice of God moving in people's lives. And now all of a sudden become so aware of it. I don't know if you're a student of revival. You should take time to look at history. See the first great awakening in America. What God did in those days is supernatural. The presence of God was so powerful that people just fall in conviction in their own homes from what they knew, what God would remind them of, what he convinced them of. They fall on the floor in the middle of the night just crying out to God for mercy because they were sinners. Desperate, desperate shape. The Welsh revivals were similar to that. People just in the middle of the night, God just speaking to them, getting saved, coming to Christ. They said there was such a movement in those mining communities during the Welsh revivals that when the workers would go to work, that the donkeys didn't know what to do anymore because all their commands were just curse words. And these guys, their lives are being so changed when they go to work, they didn't use those words anymore. They had to retrain all the mules how to work. God just doing stuff. God just showing himself mighty. We see it in scripture. We see it in history. Do it again, Lord. I do believe we are in the age of apostasy, yes. But I believe even during the age of apostasy, what causes that separation to become even more profound is those who are genuine standing up and being the light that shines for Christ. So let's be that light. Would you stand with me? Today, let's just make it real simple. And I think it's important we have times of invitation. It's time to consider what the Lord has said to us. But I would say today, if the Lord has spoken to your heart, Maybe there's someone that we were talking about, if we mentioned their, just the invite your one, that you would like to come today and just to simply put that name before the Lord, just give that up to the Father today, you know, and just, yeah, I can hear the buzz. It'll be all right. But just come to the altar. Maybe you just need to come to the altar. And just, you know, Jesus is your high priest. You don't need a pastor to pray over. You should come just get with the Lord for a moment. Just say, Lord, just stir my heart. And if you're here without Christ, you know, you have, if you have, and I, you know if you have, you've heard the voice of the Lord within your spirit and your heart of hearts. You know what God's saying to you there. It is time to surrender. And we're here to pray with you, to encourage you, to, but nobody can do that for you. The Bible says we confess with our mouth, you know, and we believe in our heart. This is your opportunity to come and just, let's just confess and believe and trust the Lord and rejoice with you in your decision. Because it is like the Bible says, a new birth, and it's a beginning point. We want to be there with you and for you as you start your journey with the Lord. Let's start it here today. Maybe you want to pray with somebody or bring somebody to the altar to pray for them. Feel free to come today. But let's just take some time with our Heavenly Father. Let's just take some time to hear what God's saying to us. To separate everything else out of our mind. Forget about anything else in the room. Just between you and the Lord. Father, we love you today. You are omniscient. You know all things. You know each and every one of our lives, our hearts. You know where we are. You know where we are in our relationship with you. And I just pray, God, that you would draw us again to yourself. You told us if we would draw nigh to you, that you would draw nigh to us. So, Father, we're coming, welcoming you to speak to us, opening our hearts to you, inviting you to do that which can't be duplicated in this world, that which only you can do in us. Do that for us and in us today. Just come, talk to the Lord, and we'll pray with somebody. Come, we'll pray with you. But whatever the Lord's laying on your heart today, let's respond to the Holy Spirit.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Father, we love you. We thank you again for grace, for mercy, for Jesus, for your word, for your Holy Spirit, for you, Father. I have no doubt in my heart and mind that the days for humanity are certainly numbered, probably closer than most of us realize. I ask in Jesus' name that you would bless us in a way that we realize that we are people, end-time people, end-time church, with a passion for you, a burden for the lost, concern for your work, the kingdom. Be glorified in us, Father. We would consider that the blessing of blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I encourage you as you leave today, if you have that name on your heart, since we're having this prayer meeting, you put that name on that board out there. Just there's some post-its out there, and there's some, just take one, write a name or two names, and stick them on the wall up there, because we will be pulling all those off and laying them on the altar. The Wednesday before that, February 5th, but there's people who come in and pray with us as well, as I do when I go out there and I see the names, different names on boards, I lift those up to the Lord. So let's continue to trust the Lord. I believe some of the very best days are ahead of us, you know, and I don't know fully the full picture of that. I just know that God's got some things he wants to do. There's no greater blessing in my life to know that I've been used by God in some way, amen, in some life. I really, that's where joy just kind of has to flow in your heart, you know, that you were... He used it to touch your life, to make a difference in a situation, in a heart or life of someone. That's what keeps you going in ministry, even as a Christian, especially as a pastor. There's lots of folks who'll tell you other stuff. You know? There's that knowledge of knowing, hey, the Lord's doing something. And I do believe that we are going to see a deeper move of God in people's, in Christians' lives, that pours out into people being saved. But we've got to come back as a church, you know, to realize the holiness of God as well as the love of God. And that God says, be ye holy as I am holy. And that means that I'm going to focus on the things in my life that they're like him. And to mature and to grow in grace and the knowledge of the word of God. And then just to live it out by loving people, loving you, loving the lost, loving folks. What do we say right here? We want to love God, love people, reach the world. That's pretty much a synopsis of what our ministry and our life is. Amen. Brother Gary's got a few closing announcements for us.
So we do have those welcome cards, and for those that push their cards and put them on another table, instead of three, you now got six. And so be sure to take those with you as you leave and pass those out. A couple of announcements we have. There are no Sunday evening activities tonight. Tonight is family night. We also have our Wednesday night services, and we're going through the harmony of the Gospels. And so we are in the Sermon on the Mount. We're going into Matthew chapter 6, so you do not want to miss that this Wednesday night. Also, for our guest and online, our guest, there's about that welcome card in the seat back in front of you. Fill that out. Love the opportunity at the end of the service. I'll be, as you exit on your left, love the opportunity to meet you, greet you, put a free gift in your hand. And then don't forget to stay connected. Finally, don't forget your tithes and offerings, three ways to give: online, in person, or you can drop a check off in office Monday through Thursday. Now, we are having our Super Bowl fellowship immediately following. I say immediately, give us about 10 minutes to set up, but we will be having our Super Bowl fellowship after church today. The serving lines will be in here, and we'll be sitting in the fellowship hall again. Give us a couple, about 10 minutes to set up, but I'm going to go ahead and pray for the meal. If you're a guest of ours, we would love the opportunity. We would love for you to stay with us. If you didn't bring anything, that's okay. Stay anyway. Just join. Be here to enjoy the fellowship. Amen. Let me go ahead and pray. Father God, we just come to you and we thank you for your grace and your mercy that is due every day, Father. We thank you for the air in our lungs, Father, because while we have air in our lungs, Father, we are to profess and your name, Father, and the gospel, Father. We thank you, Father, that you've called us to be the salt of the earth, Father, and the light, Father. The city set on a hill, Father. And Father, we should take that charge, Father, and share your word with the lost, Father. Father, we thank you for today. I thank you for this fellowship, Father. We ask that you use this food to nourish our body and our minds. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.